Today we are going to be looking at naming inorganic compounds. It's a review from 1211 so that we can make sure that we know exactly what we're talking about and that we remember how to do this, because a lot of times with 1212 we're just going to look at the names, we're going to look at the formulas, and we need to already know how to go from name to formula or formula to name. So in case you've forgotten it, here is a review of naming inorganic compounds. So, when we're naming an inorganic compound, we use what's called chemical nomenclature. This is going to be a systematic way of naming things so that everything has a unique name. So we have a unique name for every single compound or molecule. Systematic way of naming compounds and molecules. We use a system called IUPAC, the IUPAC system of naming. And with our IUPAC system, we have different ways of naming inorganic compounds versus organic compounds. We're going to look at just inorganic compounds today, and we're going to exclude acids from this talk. So, like I said, our inorganic compounds named differently from our organic compounds. With our inorganic compounds, we're going to name our cation first, then our anion. And let me really quickly reiterate, we're talking about inorganic compounds and specifically ionic inorganic compounds. As there are compounds that are covalent in nature, and they're going to be named a little bit differently. Hopefully you guys remember that. If you need me to do an additional video on naming covalent compounds, please let me know. But for our inorganic ionic compounds, we're going to name our cation first, and then our anion. How we name each of these is based on what type of cation we have, what type of anion we have. For our cations, we have simple, where our simple cation is a single atom type, and that atom type will either be an alkali metal ion, alkaline earth metal ion, or what something in our group 3A, so boron or aluminum. So we have one atom type. And here we have a set charge. So for our alkali metals, that's going to be plus one, alkaline earth metals, plus two, group 3A, so boron, aluminum, that's going to be plus three. Then we have our transition metal cations. These are going to be anything in the transition metal area, with the exception of zinc and silver. Zinc will always have a plus two charge, and silver will always have a plus one charge. Our transition metals, other than that, are going to have variable charges. We still have the one atom type, but now we have a variable charge, and as such, we have to do something additional compared to how we name our simple cations. And again, this excludes zinc, which always does zinc 2 plus, and silver, which always does silver 1 plus. Our last type of cation is going to be our polyatomic cation. Our polyatomic cation is going to be a cation that is formed from covalently bound atoms. So it's called a molecular cation. So something like ammonium, NH4 plus. Okay, now we go to our anions. Our anions, much easier to name. We have our simple. So single atom type. And a set charge. And just like with our cations, our simple cations, we can use the periodic table to determine what our charge will be. If we've got something like nitrogen, it's going to be -3, something oxygen, -2, something like fluorine would be -1. And then we have our polyatomic anions. And these are also molecular in nature, but they're just a molecular anion instead of a cation. They're going to have a set charge. They're going to have a specific name. Here is a list of all of our polyatomics. All of these polyatomics you guys should know or work out. Oops, this should be phosphate. I'll fix that. So you must know these polyatomics. We have the two at the top, ammonium and hydronium. Those are our two cations. The rest of them are anions. With very few exceptions, these are just going to be non-metals in here. Some notable exceptions are going to be permanganate, and we have chromate and dichromate. So those are ones where we actually have a metal atom within the molecular ion, but the rest of them are just non-metals. Okay, so let's look at how to actually name our cations, because that's the very first thing. So our simple cation will be named just as the atom is named. So it's the same name as the atom or element. So again, this excludes transition metals. What does it include are alkali metals. So group 1A, these are all going to be +1. Alkaline earth metals. This can be group 2A, +2, and then group 3A metals, which would be +3. So if we have something like Na plus. This is sodium ion. We just name it as sodium. Al3 plus. Aluminum ion. We just name it as aluminum. If we have a transition metal, as I said, transition metals themselves are going to be ones where we have a variable charge. So in this case, we have to include a charge indicator. The charge indicator will be a Roman numeral. In parentheses. So again, we exclude zinc. always do zinc plus 2 and silver. So what that means by excluding it, it just means we don't have to indicate the charge with zinc or silver. So if we have something like Fe3+, that iron has a 3+ charge, so it'd be iron 3. Fe2+, iron 2. Pretty simple. You may also see the Latin names. This would be our regular way of naming this. The Latin, the charge is indicated by taking the Latin beginning of the name, removing the suffix, and adding a new suffix. So if we have a lower charge, it's going to be us. A higher charge would be ick. So this would be ferric. This would be ferrous, where the ick indicates the higher charge, the us indicates the lower charge. We have another example of this. Iron plus one, or sorry, copper plus one, copper plus two. So this would be copper 1, copper 2. Copper 1 is going to be our lower charge. It'll have the us ending. It'll be cuprous. And then copper 2, cupric. Another irregular one is going to be mercury. Mercury shows up in two different ways, either Hg2, 2+, or Hg2+. So mercury in a plus one oxidation state is always mercury subscript 2, superscript 2+. So this would be mercury 1 and mercury 2. With our Latin names being Mercurius and Mercuric. Fun, right? So, just, you will never see Mercury 1 as a single atom. It'll always be 2. Okay. Our polyatomic cations, very easy. So, simple, very easy. The polyatomic is very easy. The only thing with your polyatomic cation, you're going to name it exactly as a polyatomic cation, but you have to memorize the two that are common. That'd be ammonium and hydronium. So our polyatomic ion, or cation, names the same as the cation, or as the polyatomic. And as I said, we have two different ones. We have NH4+, which is ammonium. And then H3O+, hydronium. And you can see both of them have the IUM at the end. Thing we're going to look at is our anion. So now that we know how to name our cation, that'll always go first. After that, it'll be our anion. So we'll name our cation, then our anion. First is simple, so one atom type. And we're going to be looking at our, usually we look at the periodic table to determine the charge. We have hydrogen as an anion. This is going to be in 1A. But as an anion, it's going to be it's going to be a minus one charge. Then we have group 5A. So this is going to be stuff like nitrogen, phosphorus. It's going to be a minus three. Group 6A. It's going to be our oxygen, sulfur, be minus two. Group 7A, it's going to be our fluorine, chlorine, our halogens, minus one. Okay? And then those charges do not vary. So we just name them all the same way. We're going to drop the ending of the element name and add the suffix IDE. So we have H minus, it's going to be hydride. If we have N3 minus nitride, O2 minus oxide, F minus fluoride. Remember, the IDE ending is a simple anion. If you see any other anion ending, it is not simple. It's polyatomic. One of the things that confuses a lot of people. Our polyatomics themselves will have some ending other than IDE. So polyatomics, this is where we name the anion as the polyatomic anion. So very important that you have memorized that polyatomic ion chart. There are very few that end with the IDE ending, but there are a couple. OH, hydroxide, CN, cyanide, O2, 2 minus, peroxide. So the beginnings here, so to kind of compare these to our simple anions, they are not element names at the beginning. We have hydrogen and oxygen combined to make hydroxide. And then carbon and nitrogen is kind of combined to make cyanide. And then with our two oxygens, we get peroxide. There are oftentimes when we have polyatomic ions that have the same atom, or a common atom with different numbers of oxygens, and they'll be named differently. They'll also have the same charge. So we have multiple, what we call oxyanions. So same element, variable number of oxygens, same charge. So we're looking at with this example of this would be NO3 minus, NO2 minus. In this case, they're going to be named differently. The one with the greater number of oxygens will get an ATE ending. The one with the lower number of oxygen will get an ITE ending. So this would be nitrate, nitrite. We get the same thing with sulfur. SO4 2 minus, SO3 2 minus. This would be sulfate, sulfite, and we also get it for phosphorus. Phosphorus will have PO4 3 minus, PO3 3 minus. This would be phosphate and phosphite. So just some ways to kind of remember your polyatomics. Now, this is how we deal with it if we have only two within an element series. If we have more than two, for instance, four, we can't just use eight and eight. We have to include a prefix. So if we have four in a series, then we are going to move on to adding a prefix. This is four oxyanions in a series. So we're talking about all the same element bonded to different numbers of oxygens. Okay, so chlorine has four different oxyanions. So that's ClO4 minus, ClO3 minus, ClO2 minus, and then ClO minus. Same charge, different number of oxygens. We're going to go right in the middle. So this is right in our middle. The larger will have an 8 ending, the smaller will have an 8 ending. So this will be chlorate, and then this will be chlorite. Then we're going to add a prefix to indicate the one with the highest number of oxygens, indicate the one with the lower number of oxygens. So we add per to the one with the greatest number of oxygens, we add hypo to the one with the least number of oxygens. So this would be perchlorate, and this would be hypo. Chlorite. Okay. Here's just a chart showing some examples of different polyatomic anions or oxyanions that you can see. So it's interesting. Okay. These are anions. And as such, they have a negative charge. We can take that charge and reduce it by adding hydrogens in there. When we do this, we decrease our charge. So we're going to make new polyatomic ions by adding H plus ions. The charge must be 2 minus or greater in order to go from a polyatomic ion with a larger charge to a polyatomic ion with a smaller charge. If you have a minus 1, it'll just go to a regular molecule. So some examples, we have carbonate. We add a hydrogen to it, we get HCO3 minus. Okay, so that's decreased our charge by one because we've added a plus charge. So we've added one hydrogen, so we add hydrogen as a name. So this would be hydrogen carbonate. Another name for this would be bicarbonate. We do the same thing with PO4, 3 minus, we add a hydrogen, we get HPO4, 2 minus, we went from phosphate to hydrogen phosphate. And since we still have a charge greater than minus 1, we could add another hydrogen in here and still have a polyatomic. So we take our hydrogen phosphate, add one more hydrogen to that. We get H2PO4 minus, and we call this dihydrogen phosphate. Okay, so I'm going to go over a couple of examples, but that is going to wrap up how we name inorganic compounds or ionic compounds that are inorganic in nature. So let's try a couple of examples and then in a later lecture I will go over how to name acids when we get to chapter 14. Okay, so let's look at these different examples. So the first one here, we have this and this. So we have NH4 plus and then Cl minus. So these are two polyatomics added together. The first polyatomic, NH4 plus, we call ammonium. And then Cl minus is a symbol anion, so it's just be chloride. FeNO3, 3, we've got iron in its plus 3 oxidation state, or charge of plus 3, and then NO3, which is nitrate. Iron is a transition metal, so we need to indicate the charge. So this is iron 3, nitrate. Now we could, of course, name it as its Latin name, so we could name it as ferrous, ferric, if we so chose. So this could also be ferric nitrate. Okay. Here we have lead and then sulfite. So lead is a variable charge. So we do lead for sulfite. Okay, move on. We can also go from name to formula. We have titanium acetate. Acetate, for anybody who does not remember, is C2H3O2. Acetate has a minus 1 charge. We have titanium 2, that means titanium is in a plus 2 charge. So we have minus 1 for the acetate, plus 2 for the titanium. So we're going to need 2 acetates for every titanium. And we get this formula. Lead, it's a variable charge. So lead 2 nitride. Nitride, IDE ending. That indicates, with a few small examples, generally an IDE ending means we're talking about a simple anion. In this case, we're talking about nitrogen. Nitride has a minus 3 charge. Lead is a plus 2 charge. So in order to balance them out, we need 3 leads, 2 nitrogens. So we're going to be PB3N2. Chromium 3 hydroxide. Hydroxide. Hydro. Ox. We know that is not an element name, so we know that that's going to be a polyatomic. Hydroxide is OH minus. We have chromium 3 plus, so we need 3 hydroxides for every chromium, like so. That concludes the review. Hope you guys